Good afternoon, everyone. This is Chaitali Bagh from the European Bureau of Aviation and Defense Universe based out of Cyprus. Today we have with us Mr. Pulak Sen, founder MRO Association of India. With the euphoria of the Air India being sold to Tatas has just settled and a realization dawned that the Air India Engineering Services, which is also the biggest MRO in the country, is not a part of the deal. Is it a pro or a con for Government of India? Will Tatas benefit by this decision? Will Air India disinvestment be incomplete? Mr. Pulak Sen is here to brainstorm with ADU these issues, which are not only important, but extremely relevant in the current scenario. Welcome to you, sir. And now I request Editor Sangeeta Saxena, ADU, to steer the discussion ahead.
Thank you, Chaitali. Just wonderful to have Mr. Pulak Sen with us. And for all our viewers, you know, it's important to let them know that the MRO came together under an umbrella because of him. And he is just the right person to, in the scenario, to tell us about what has happened with the deal, where the MRO has been left behind with the previous owners. Pulakda, we'll start with it. Welcome to the show. And we'd like to start with it. Why did it happen?
Thank you, Chaitali and Sangeeta ji. I am pleased that to come on ADU channel for the first time. To answer your question, Sangeeta ji, Air India Express and part of AI stacks was sold off by the government to Tatas. But they kept AISL as a separate engineering company. And I think it is very nascent to say that how it will progress further. But there are some points that I would like to say. The government is also looking at hiving off Air India Engineering Services maybe next year. So if you can further your questions, I will answer.
Right, Pulak, absolutely right when you say that. But then tell me one thing. It's the only MRO Air India has, the biggest in the country, and its clientele was majorly Air India. So does that make it redundant now? Even if it's a part of the Government of India, it becomes absolutely redundant in that case, does it?
No. I will give you a brief summary of what is the current situation. As you said, Air India Engineering Services is the largest MRO in the country. And being a part of Air India and a government entity, the government has spent a lot of money in developing infrastructure. They have got around 16 stations all over India. They have major engineering bases in Nagpur, the newest one. They have a base in Hyderabad, Delhi, Bombay. Even an engine test cell in Nagpur catering to the GE engine. They today have a staff strength of 1,957 people, out of which 1,266 are permanent, and they have around 691 staff, which is actually, they call it fixed-term employees who are employed in back offices of Air India Engineering for 5 years. After that, if that is their service life, if Air India requires them to further the service, they will have to sit for an exam and do it. Out of the 16 stations, as I told you, Air India Engineering Service, from wing an aircraft to major maintenance, line maintenance, engine facility, as I told you, test bed, as I told you, landing gear facilities in Delhi and Mumbai. They have a wonderful APU center in Kolkata. They have avionics and component workshop, a big one in Hyderabad. And they have seats and galley repair facilities in Bombay as well as other places. So to tell you, this will remain as a backbone for the country, and it will strengthen Air India, because in some time ago, Air India had signed an agreement with Air India Engineering Service for a maintenance service agreement, they call it MSA, which is still running till December 2024. So Air India will not remain without an MRO support. Only the rates that were fixed during the government times, they may be revised. So to tell in a brief statement that the new Air India owned by Tata will still take the services of Air India Engineering Service up till 2024. Thank you.
Okay. So which means that the manpower, the technically qualified manpower, which is there in abundance here, that has some job.
Yes, they will have a job.
They have
beyond, some job. Yeah, beyond that 2024 period, as I told you at the very beginning, that government is thinking of hiving off Air India Engineering Service also. Who would be the taker? We don't know still. The process will start only after Air India is handed over to Tata's in December. And beyond that, the government is going to put its head on.
Also that, Air India Engineering Services also has a lot of clients, which are, foreign airlines and domestic airlines for line maintenance checks and other checks. So what does it mean? Will it continue? Will this continue?
Very good question. Air India, having so many facilities across India and abroad, they have some unit which is a subsidiary of Air India in Sharjah, in Sri Lanka, in Nepal, where they are doing line maintenance of various airlines. Apart from that, they are also doing line maintenance and a little bit of major maintenance in India as well. So out of their total revenue, last revenue that I know was 35,000 crores, 15% of that is derived from the third-party revenue, third-party maintenance revenue. So it will continue.
It will continue. And also that the five major MRO centers in the five big cities, now will that become, with remaining but less work, Will that result into a merger of some, and you have eventually you're left only with one or two, or these five continue?
The five will continue. They will, as I told you, they will have Air India business because Air India Express main MRO is in Trivandrum, as you know.
Yeah.
737s are done there. And the other two major hubs are Delhi and Bombay, where wide body is done, and the engines. In Bombay, the CFMI engine is done, and in Delhi, the LEAP engine is done. And in Nagpur, they have an engine test cell, which is they have done with GE. So they are doing up to GE90 engines over there. So these facilities will remain and serve Air India, the Tata owned Air India, but the, in my opinion, they will have to look at third party business to have their hands full, their plates full. So it needs a very big push for the small organization. In no mean terms, they are small. They are widespread, big organization, but the number of staff is really small. But they will have to look for third party business in more scale than they are doing now.
Also, sir, Alliance Air has not been, awarded off. So it still remains with Government of India.
Yeah.
Now, because Alliance Air is there with them, the tier two, tier three cities are still under it. And the Udaan scheme also has, beneath the tier two, tier three, also there are those regional connectivities which are there. Now, will the MRO continue to do it for them? Because then, or were they actually, it was doing it for these Alliance Air planes also? And it continues for them?
Yeah, Alliance Air planes are ATRs, as you are aware.
Yeah, yeah.
And ATRs are done in Kolkata. So they are doing these things in Kolkata, MRO. And they are doing a good job. And Air India Engineering Service has the capability and the expertise and the manpower to do all sort of aircraft that are operating in India, so that, as I said, that they have to take commercially some decision that they have to substantiate their revenue from third party. So Air India Alliance's ATRs will be done by Air India Engineering. So that is also there, but that in volume, if you divide minus Air India as such and Air India Express, it's not very much.
It's very basic pittance. And then what happens in that case, which I wanted to understand from you, was that, what happens with that is a real deep fall in the revenue for the Air India Engineering Services. Will it be able to sustain? Just Alliance Air will be sustained?
No, they will not be able to sustain. As I said in the very beginning, the government is looking at hiving off Air India Engineering Services in year 2022. So it will take some time for the, as you know, this Air India bid it started in 2017 and it is 2021 that the entire deal has to be put in place. But having said so, the government machinery, which worked for the disinvestment of Air India, now know exactly how to do it. So they have, a way forward for them, so that they know exactly whom to tap, where to tap. So you will very soon see a RFP from the government for Air India Engineering. And let me tell you something, Air India Engineering Services in 2017, there were outside foreign companies, they were OEM MROs who had offered to take over all the facilities of Air India Engineering and give a revenue share to the government or Air India. But that was very nascent stage and the government did not put in the plan to do it that way. I think they will go that step. Or it can be maybe another Indian conglomerate will acquire Air India Engineering and they may take in a foreign management partner.
That can be one of the propositions. Yeah. Also, one one thing which I wanted to understand was that once this happens in 2022, the contract for Tata's continues to 24. Then what happens in those 2 years? Suppose you you have the disinvestment for Air India Engineering happens and it's done. Then what happens? Because Tata's will need.
I have no clue on that because I am not the government. But in my thinking as an aviation professional, I see that whoever is the new owner of Air India Engineering Services, they will continue with this robust contract that they have till 2024, because this is a source of revenue. Like Air India has, what are Tata's getting out of Air India? They are getting Terminal 3, I am told, will be entirely for them. Then they are getting so many international routes, traffic rights. They are getting slots at international airports. They are, of course, the domestic traffic is also there. They are gaining by the bilaterals. And at this time, I don't think the bubble flights will continue beyond 2021. And even if they happen, that will also be for Air India. So, having said so, the engineering, if the new owners come in, they'll be happy to have this contract, maintenance service contract, with the largest company in India. They will look at other airlines to participate with them, but participate in the sense, take their services. But this is a very robust contract that they would gain. That's what I wanted to say.
So that's the fact that this disinvestment of Air India has happened. It's gone to Tata's. Now the world is absolutely very happy about it. And India, of course, is extremely happy about Tata's having bought it with the reputation Tata has. So to keeping that in mind, has this disinvestment or will this disinvestment affect the MRO industry?
This disinvestment will not affect the MRO industry in adverse way, but as an MRO association founder, I think even when Air India Engineering Service is there to cater to the need of Air India, it would be nice for Air India's new owners to try out the other third-party MROs like JMR and Airworks and others to outsource their work to them so that they can judge the turnaround time, the cost factor involved, and perhaps they would want Air India Engineering to come to that level of expertise. Let me assure the audience when I am talking to you, COVID-19 had a very marginal impact on the MRO industry in India. What had happened, how we survived, is all these aircraft that were parked, they had, the airlines took a decision to retire them or give them back to the lessors. And two third-party MROs, Airworks and GMR, had been obliged with lots of lease return work. So this kept the industry, maybe we never met the profit, but we had work and we had money flowing in. Though the situation is still not over, but I would like to assure the viewers on your channel that India is not suffering in this pandemic so much. And they, you know, our Prime Minister's statement for Make in India, he has invited OEMs and MROs to put up shops in India, and they are willing to do it. And you are also aware that the new Civil Aviation Ministry and the Minister has announced that they are thinking of enhancing the 2016 MRO, the National Civil Aviation Policy, with a fresh MRO policy. Let me also tell you that in the new policy, what the existing MROs face, royalty problem, and mainly that, and that will be addressed, and no royalty will be charged by airport owners, especially Air India, Airport Authority of India. Then we have the reduction in IGST, which is helping the MRO industry.
In continuation to this,
yes,
we have, you know, we in India, now when I'm talking to you, I'm just going a little beyond Air India.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to understand that in India, we've got MROs. MROs of good repute. But somehow we are not being able to get in business from the nearby, even the nearby countries. So, you know, there's a market, import market, which should have been there for MROs. It's not there. So how do we, what do we do? You know, what does, as an MRO association, what do you think should be the advice to these MROs? How should they plan out so that, you know, they get in the business from, at least from the neighboring countries?
To answer, very nice question, to answer your question, before the pandemic hit us, both the third-party MROs of India, Airworks and GMR, had around 40%, one had 45% of export business. And that not only came from the neighboring countries, they also came from far off Africa.
Yeah.
That business they will continue, and I am sure they want to make it 50% of the total revenue. So it is coming. And Air India Engineering is also serving in foreign land, foreign destinations, and they are making money in foreign currency and giving it to the country's exchequer. That is a very good move by the Indian MRO industry to capture business from overseas and contribute to the national exchequer. And I'm sure this will grow.
They do it in India? Is it in India? It comes in and then they do, the plane comes into India and then the MROs and the checks are done here? Or yeah, do they have their lines outside and they have their infrastructure outside?
Air India has its lines outside, but GMR and Airworks, they get aircraft from not only the neighboring countries. I have seen aircraft in GMR from UK, which has come for major maintenance. And they are doing it. Four aircraft I saw, which were there from UK, one aircraft from Bangladesh, one from Nepal, and Air India Engineering, Airworks and GMR, they have got certification, not only from FAA and EASA, they have got from many other countries whose work they are doing in India.
So So which means that it's not that you don't have an export-import market for the MRO, you do have.
Yes, I will go a little one step further. The OEMs are now looking at India as their next market. And they are holding hands with Aerida Engineering, especially like Pratt & Whitney, GE, Rolls-Royce. They have started small programs with Aerida Engineering, or Safran for the matter, are having small programs with Aerida Engineering so that they are giving some expertise to Aerida, and Aerida is building on it, and Aerida Engineering, and it's become a test bed for further cooperation between OEMs and MROs. So it's going in a very right direction, if I may use the word, to be something like Singapore. The closest that I can think of is Singapore. Singapore industry, MRO industry, is a very big industry, as you are already aware. But it took the government of Singapore to plan it in a 10-year program, which is what I think the Indian government should look at. Now, the focus is at MRO. So we should have a 10-year long program and give other benefits if people come, foreign MROs come and open their offices or factories here, or MROs here.
Just before I wind up, Mr. Sen, I'd like to ask you one thing. You know, if you recall, Boeing had started a MRO in Nagpur with Air India for its planes. Now, some MRO work would have been going to that MRO also, isn't it? So what happens in that case? You know, obviously, that work was not with Air India Engineering. So what happens in that case? That will that continue on a Tata's Boeing? What should happen in such a case? I know you will not be privy to it, but then presumably what should happen in such a situation?
May I tell you something here? The Nagpur facility was an offset facility. It came from offset.
Came from offsets.
Yeah. Air India had bought some aircraft. Indian Airlines had brought some aircraft long ago. And out of that, the offset clause with Boeing was they would build and fund an MRO. So this Nagpur MRO is under Air India Engineering Service. And it is one of the finest MRO with latest technology. I should invite you to go there and visit yourself and see how it is. I'm sure my member Air India Engineering Services will open its door for you. It is one of the finest examples. Boeing built the structure. It funded the tool shop, everything, jigs and tools and everything. They spent around $107 million for Boeing's grant came from there. Additionally, Air India spent some little money in it. It cost $117 million. So the rest was paid by Air India. By the side of Nagpur hangar, in the same compound, GE has done the G90 test bed.
Yeah.
So that is also an offset program. So this is what we could achieve in the civilian front from offset. In defense, as you know, there is offset clause.
Yes.
Another thing before I close here, I would like to tell the audience from your platform, India is very serious in civil-military cooperation in the field of MRO. And talks are going on between the Ministry of Civil Aviation and Ministry of defense, and it has progressed quite a lot. And the Niti Aayog is involved in this. And when I say Niti Aayog, you know the big office is involved in it. And they want to bring military MRO, maybe not the tactical weapon platform, but transport and other things, which are much less sensitive, to the Indian MRO. And they are, the beauty of Indian Air Force is they want to hold a hand for the first example that comes out of the hangars, and they are doing that very well. Even though Indian MROs are working for Indian Air Force, but with Semilac certification, but they have to go into the base maintenance repair, base repair depots of IAF to do that. So hopefully someday, like Germany has MROs, civil and military together, and other countries, hopefully, maybe in 5 years' time, we'll see that coming in also.
Thank you so much, Mr. Sen. It was wonderful speaking with you. And I'm sure not only our audience, we are also enlightened on a subject which we really didn't know much about. And I always felt, you know, it's a very sad story that Air India Engineering has not got disinvested along with Air India. Now you've given us food for thought. Thank you very much for it. You know, it's really wonderful to have you on the show. And we hope that whenever there's a story on MRO at the created in India, I'm sure you'll be there to, you know, guide us and tell us as to what the story is all about. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, both Chaitali and Sangeeta ji. It's been a wonderful talking to you. I hope that this makes sense to your audience. Thank you very much.
I'm sure it will. I'm sure it will.
Thank you so much, Pulak sir. Thank you so much, ma'am. It was, as usual, very absorbing. And I was telling Pulak sir before we started the session that Air India and this the Tata taking it over, it is going to be important for not only people living in India, but also the NRIs, the expats who are outside India. Everybody will be very interested to hear all about it. Thank you so much for this session. Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Thank you.
Bye, sir. Bye. Have a nice evening ahead. Bye.